Today we are going to read the story The Window of ORC Class 6. Before the reading, let me give you the summary of the lesson. The lesson starts with an introduction to emails, how an email is composed and sent through computer to different people at a time. If you don't have a computer, you can visit a cyber cafe and use a computer and net there. An email can be sent to different people all over the world by just a click of a button. All the people react differently to it. Some might delete it, some might keep it to read it later, and some might send it there and then to different people in their contact list. Now Sarah has read a story and she was impressed by that story, so she attached the story with her email to Brad as he was her friend. The story is about two young men, Peter and Joseph. Peter has serious lung problem and Joseph has had an accident and could not move from his place. They both become friends and start talking to each other in a hospital room. They share about their lives and places they visited during vacation. The doctors had allowed Peter to sit up in bed for 1 hour every day, as his bed was near the window, so Joseph asked him to describe the scene out of the window. Peter would start describing the beautiful park, the lake, the busy street, and the city beyond. Joseph passed his days dreaming and visualizing the scenes of the park, and he slowly regained his health. But unfortunately, one day, Joseph got the news that Peter had died during the night. So he asked the nurse to shift him to the bed beside the window so that he could sit up in bed and look out of the window himself. But when he sat up in bed, he saw that there was a brick wall outside the window. On asking the nurse about the wall and Peter's description of the scene outside, he got to know that Peter was blind. And then he realized how selfless Peter had been and how he made him pass his time visualizing a beautiful scene and life outside and stay positive to regain his strength and health. Let's start the reading, and while reading, I am going to explain the passages. Do you have a computer at home? Do you get to use one at school? Have you ever sent an email to your friend? Of course, you might have a computer at home. You do use a computer at school, and you might have seen someone send an email. In our world today, there are computers everywhere. Millions of people keep in touch with each other through the net. Net means internet. And emails means electronic mails, by sending emails. They don't write letters anymore. Even if you don't have a computer at home, you can easily pop up into a cyber cafe on the street and pay to use a computer for an hour or so. Cyber cafe is a net cafe, anywhere, it can be anywhere. Pop into means go into, and you have to pay for the time that you use the computer and the net over there. When a message is composed as an email, it can be sent to many different people at the click of a button on the keyboard. For writing an email, you need to have an email address of the person you want to send the email to. And you can send many emails at a time by just a click of a button. The email can go to all your friends at one time. And when your friends receive the email, each will deal with it in a different way. They might react to it different way. Some will read it, and if they like it, may file it away to read again another day. Some will read the email and delete it straight away. I don't know why I'm being sent such rubbish, they will say to themselves. And some will like what they have received and will want to share it immediately with others. They will forward your email to everyone in their address book. It is very easy to forward if you use computer, and you might see that there is just a click of a button and you can forward your email to many people at a time. Some emails messages are sent out to make others aware of a particular piece of news. Some email contains jokes. Some are simply stories with a message, and here is one of them. Emails may contain jokes, news, or they can be stories. You can also attach pictures with your emails and send it to other people. Now, this is a picture of an email which is from Sarah Corzana. Her email address is written in front of it to Brad Petroveri. His email address is written in front of it. It was sent on Tuesday, September 21st, 2002, 7:04 p.m. Subject, the window, the story which she is going to attach with it. This email begins, "Dear Brad, thought you would like this story, so read on. It made me feel sad, but like the man in the story, I wanted to share it with you because you are a friend and I think about you quite often. I want you to know I care about you and I'm wishing you well. Your loving friend, Sarah." The first thing that you notice when you read this email is that there are no capital letters and many words are written in short forms. So this is the beauty of it. You can write an email and quickly just write it without having to write full words or writing capital letters. No punctuation is addressed in this email. P.S. Let me know if you have any trouble opening the attachment. I shall send it in some other format if you cannot open the file. The file is the story which she has sent. And she is asking him, telling him that she can send the story in another format. There are many formats by which you can send one file or the other. Now here the story begins. The story is about Peter and Joseph. Peter had a serious problem with his lungs. He was taken to a hospital and moved into a small ward and put in a bed by the only window in the room. The doctor said that he would be allowed to sit up in bed in his bed for just 1 hour each afternoon. Peter was admitted in a hospital. He was given a small room and his bed was placed beside the window. And doctor told him to sit up in bed for just 1 hour each afternoon. "This will help to drain the fluid from your lungs," they told him. "Make yourself as comfortable as possible. You will enjoy the fresh air coming in from the window." During the night, another patient was admitted to the same ward. Who do you think the another patient was? Of course, it was Joseph. He was put in bed next to Peter's. He had been involved in an accident and had a serious problem with his back. The test would be extensive and he was probably going to be in the hospital for quite some while. Now Joseph was in an accident and had injured his spine. There would be many tests and he had to stay in the hospital for quite some time. "You must on no account sit up, so don't even try to get out of a bed," said the doctors. "You are seriously ill and you must lie flat. Your vertebrae needs time to heal." Vertebrae means spinal cord. So the doctors cautioned him not to sit up in his bed or move from his place. He had to lie flat and even he could not move his head. The following morning, after the nurses and the doctors had been on their rounds to see the other patients, the two men began to talk to each other. Now next day, when the doctors had done their rounds, they started to talk to each other. "What's your name?" asked Peter from his bed by the window. At first, the man in the next bed did not reply. Joseph did not reply because he could not understand, as he could not move his head. So he could not see Peter in the other bed. He did not know where the question came from or to whom it was addressed. All he could see was a point on the cold, white ceiling directly above him. Ceiling means roof. So Joseph was only looking at the cold, white ceiling roof directly above him. He could not see to right or left. "Are you talking to me?" he asked after a long pause. "Yes," said Peter, "I am in the bed next to yours. My name is Peter." "I'm Joseph," said the other man. "You can call me Joe." As the morning drew on, the two men talked and talked. What else was there to do in the hospital, especially if you had been told to lie flat on your back all day? The men did not speak about what had brought them into the hospital. This is a very important point, that they did not talk about their injuries or their illness or their cause of being in the hospital. They spoke of things beyond the four walls of the ward, about their wives and families, the places they had visited during their vacation, of seeing things and done, and wonderful journeys made in wide and colorful world outside. The days passed on peacefully enough. So they became friends and they talked about their families and their vacations and the journeys they had made. And the days started to pass very easily. Each afternoon, Peter was allowed to sit up in bed for an hour. So he did so. A shadow would fall across Joseph's bed. As Joseph could not see if Peter was sitting in his bed or not, so when his shadow would fall on across Joseph's bed, he would realize and understand that Peter was sitting up. Then he would tell him, "Tell me about the world outside," Joseph would say as he stared at the ceiling. "You are by the window, you lucky fellow. There's nothing much happening on the ceiling today, not even a spider or a fly." And Peter would tell him, "It's a bright day today. The window overlooks a park with a lovely lake. There are ducks and swans splashing on the water, and around the lake there is a lush green lawn surrounded by flower beds. Some children are sailing their model boats on the sparkling water of the lake. Such a deep blue, much darker than that of a sky, and yet much brighter because of the reflected sunlight." Now this is the description of the park that Peter would have seen outside the window, and he describes how there are children sailing their boats, there are flower beds and a water of the lake, and the color of the lake is much darker because of the reflected sunlight. In his mind's eye, Joseph would visualize the bright, cheerful scene outside the window, and he felt warm and comfortable inside. "Young couples are walking," continued Peter, "and now one young man is picking a scarlet rose and handing it to his wife. How many flowers there are, and what stunning colors." Peter would describe that in the park he could see young couples, and one man is picking a red rose and giving it to his wife, and he would tell him how beautiful flowers there are and there are beautiful colors in the park. "What lies beyond the park, Peter?" "Beyond the park? Why, there is a busy street. Red buses are rattling along, and black and yellow taxis weave in and out of the other cars. They obviously know their way around the city better than the others." So he describes the busy streets, that there are buses which are moving forward and black and yellow taxis which move and overtake other cars and move forward because they know their way around the city better than the other drivers. "And beyond the busy streets, there is a spectacular skyline, old grey buildings and sparkling new glass and metal ones that almost reach the clouds. A church steeple pointing proudly to the heavens, a round dome, more sober. A tall tower bristling with antenna, perhaps to send and receive signals of some kind. All of them magnificent structures. Magnificent, beautiful, grand structures. Tall, grand, beautiful structures." And then the nurse would come in and say, "Now, Peter, it is time to lie down again. Your hour is up." And they would ease him back into his bed. This was a description of the city, which he described, that grey buildings and beautiful glass metal ones, buildings are there, beautiful skyline, and there are antenna on the towers to receive or send signals. This was all the description of the city that he could see. Joseph began to live for those one-hour sessions when Peter would describe the wonderful world outside. A few more days went by, and life in the hospital ward continued as usual. The nurses would come in, help Peter sit up, and then leave. And Peter would begin his descriptions. A parade passing along the high street. This might be one description of parade marching through the high street. Of the clouds of all shapes and sizes fleeting across the sky. Fleeting? Flying. Clouds of all sizes and shapes moving across the sky. A spectacular rainbow after a shower of rain. Birds getting up to all kinds of tricks and frolicking in the water of the lake. Frolicking, playing, or moving happily. interesting people in the park, and so much more. Each day there was a new scene to describe, and each day Joseph stared at the ceiling or shut his eyes and imagined the scene, and slowly, very slowly, Joseph's health improved. By describing the scene and describing the sky and the rainbow and the birds and the lake and the people, Peter tried to give hope to Joseph that there was a life beyond these four walls of the hospital room, and he would be hopeful towards his life and start getting better. But then one morning, some days later, the nurses did not come to help Peter sit up in bed. He was not there. Joseph feared the worst. What do you think Joseph feared? Of course, he feared the worst, that Peter might have died. "Where is Peter?" he asked one of the nurses later that morning, and she told him the sad news. Peter had died during the night. Joseph was heartbroken. His mornings would not be the same without Peter to help him pass the long hours of the day. The following morning, Joseph asked if he might be moved to the bed by the window. He was feeling much better now, and he was getting stronger by the day. He would soon be able to sit up himself and gaze out of the window. Gaze means look out of the window. In due course, Joseph was moved into the bed by the window. In the afternoon, with a little help from one of the nurses, he was propped up and sitting in bed, helped up to sit in the bed. Propped up means helped up. He looked out of the window for the first time. All that he could see was the brick wall of the building next door. Joseph called for the nurse. Why do you think he called for the nurse? Because he wanted to know why there was a brick wall outside the window. "Tell me, nurse," said Joseph, "when was that ugly wall built outside the window?" "Years ago," replied the nurse. "But that can't be possible," exclaimed Joseph. "Only the other day, Peter was describing to me how the falling leaves were forming a yellow and red carpet on the lawns of the park." "Peter?" said the nurse in surprise. "What could poor Peter have described to you? He was blind. He could not even see that brick wall, even if he had wanted to." Joseph eased himself back on his pillow. A large tear trickled down his cheek. Trickle means move down slowly like a droplet. Now Joseph realized that Peter was blind, and he made up all the stories, all the scenes of the busy street or the city beyond or the park to keep Joseph hopeful for life. And he realized there and then, that's why he for the first time had a tear in his eyes when he realized how Peter worked hard to keep him company and to keep him hopeful to regain his health. That's it for today. See you next time. I've been pushing for a little bit. I've been mistakes coming.